You lucky people, I get to do the stats. Okay, and you get to listen to the most boring sound in Brummie 1999 to 2006 inclusive. So I'm going to try and go through it. If anyone has any questions, raise your hands. If anyone's got any questions, then raise your hands, we'll go through it. Obviously, the bathrooms are through there. If anyone needs the bathroom, whatever, then just go through. You get up and leave as you want, okay? I'm going to have a quick review of the injury and incidents that's gone on. And I'm trying to look at the overall picture of what's happened over the last few years. And I'm looking from 2014 through to 2016. The first thing is, what I think I'm doing is I'm already talking to the converted. You guys are here, you're bothering to learn, and you've got an interest in what's going on. Okay, so I want you to take some of it away, and hopefully it'll rub off on some of the guys who are at your own drop zone. The information I've taken is obviously from the BPA forms. The BPA forms, the information has been given to me as a database. I have no names, no center details. Okay, so it's hard to put some of the stats against what's going on, sort of thing. Okay, and I'm not here to have any blame or anything to anybody. And I've just had the basic data to go through. Okay, so this is like the first level of analysis, sort of thing, guys. Okay. Now obviously, the reports are filled in, as Reg had said. So my first word of advice is never work with children, animals, or Reg. I have been, and so with statistics is that quote that there's lies, damn lies, and then there's statistics. Okay, so I've already been misquoted by Reg before I've even spoken. So we're going to go through it. So thanks for pulling the hand grenade pin, Reg. All right. Like I say, though, the more information we can get through, the better, the clearer it is, the easier it will be for us to look at trends and everything like that. So I didn't realise you'd pop back up. What are you going to do now? The other thing that we've got is that we have no near-miss data. Okay, we have incidents that are reported. Okay, so we don't have all the injury reports. We generally get all the MALs. Okay, that's the one thing. I think we are very good at reporting the MALs. I don't think stuff doesn't get reported. Okay, it may not be reported as clearly as it could be, but I don't think stuff isn't reported. I've never seen somebody had a MAL and it not be reported. Okay, so I think that we do have good practice there. Okay, but what we don't have is that near miss thing. Let's face it, who hasn't got up on the Monday morning with a sore ankle from a landing that they had the day before? We won't have reported that. And I think if anybody in here would say that, oh, it's never happened, I think you'd be lying. And that's the thing, we've got to be self-respecting. We've got to look at our own reports and stuff. So I've gone back through. So in 2014, 67 MALs. Now, the rate. But oh, it's still doing it, Jeff. It cunningly deleted all the formatting this morning. Yeah, okay. I'll keep it simple. Okay, so outliers. We have incidents, okay? There are the malfunctions, the canopies that don't work. Okay, we'll come on to those in a moment, okay? The canopies don't work, and then we have the outliers, like we talked about, like the interesting video that we saw there, okay? So like in 2014, one total, a drone got going. Three premature deployments. That was somebody moving towards the door, knocking a reserve pin. One was a main that got done. We had a ripped canopy. We had various drogue issues, drogues not set in, drogues detaching. Okay, and six maintenance ones. And maintenance ones, three broken kill lines. Now, obviously, on the next system, that's an extremely important failure. Okay, that shouldn't be happening. Okay, and that comes down to our maintenance. Two broken brake lines and one broken main line. Okay, so in 2015, we had 55 MALs. So the number's gone down. We didn't do as many jumps that year. But the rate ended up being the same sort of the same per year. The incident rate hadn't dropped, okay, per thousand. Then in that year we had three maintenance issues, which was again two broken steering lines, one broken main line, and then we had some good ones where a student managed to pull the reserve handle for the TI. I think using it as a helpful handle to move themselves around and make themselves more comfortable while the side clips were being undone. One drogue wrapped around the student. One top hook disconnected on exit. One premature reserve deployment from non-location of a primary. The instructor then went for the secondary, and because of the excess Velcro on the tab on the next system on the secondary, they managed to take the cutaway pad away with it. Okay. Four brakes locked on. Okay. So we have all these outliers which happen, as well as the other canopy stuff. But there's no real trend in there, what's going on, okay? That I can see. In 2016, 51 miles, that's 0.86. That's gone down from 1 in 1,000 to 0.86. So it is going down. Okay, we are in the right way. And that was with the most jumps that we've done, 58,880, okay? Now, you can't see it on there because I decided to delete it. There was one side spin in there. Okay? I think it'll come back up again. Bloody thing. One side spin, one drogue wrapped around, okay, and a couple of issues like that. One was an unset drogue, which was dealt with properly, okay, whereas if most of you will know about the fatality in Lodi, it wasn't dealt with properly and it killed two people, okay? So we have these outliers, and they're there and they're getting reported, okay? Now if we go, okay. If we go to the pack inside, okay, the canopies that didn't work. So what I've done is I've gone through, I've looked at what was, you know, in air side, what was parachute inside, you know, the parachutes and that. So four brakes locked on, 19 distorted canopies. So that's where people will have said it's distorted canopy. Some will say it's a line over. Some will say the end cell was closed, tucked under. You know, it's very difficult for me to categorise that, okay? So this is all a little bit subjective how I've looked at it, okay? 19 were reported explicitly as tension knots, okay? 10 as twists. Now, the twists are always caused by the packers. The packers say that the twists are always caused by the body position of the instructors, okay? Let's face it, none of us were ever turning when we pulled that handle to stop it, okay? Ever. All right. So without the twist, 62% of the mouths were caused by the packing. Okay, tension knots, you know, lines not under tension. Now, tension knots can be caused by so many varying things, which I know Kenneth will talk about. Okay, it's not just the fact that, you know, we got line dump. It could have been the bungee condition. It could have been the tension at which the lines were packed. It's how the bag came out. Okay, it's the condition of the drogue as well, how it lifts everything out. There are so many variables in there. Okay. But if you include the twist, because it is all the packer's fault, all right, it's 77%. Okay, so, you know, the packing, we need to look at the packing. So that's 2014. 2015, again, four brakes, not set. You know, this is people either setting them on the landing area. You know, we had it in Spain the other week, okay. The guy had been caught. The guy on the landing area tucked it through, cunningly trapped it around the ring, set the brake on the signal system. On the Icarus, which has got no brake settings, so it can't be a brake fire anyway, goes down, the packer picks it, oh yeah, the brakes are set, runs it straight up the lines, packs it, the instructor jumps it, can't get the brakes off. Okay, it's that committee pack inside sort of thing, you know, we need to be aware of. You know, the guy in diesel control, the catcher, was only trying to help, but he helped cause them out. Okay, and so then 2015, similar sort of thing, 18 distorted, 16 tension knots, 9 twists. Okay, so if we include the twist in there, because it's all the packer's fault, it's 85% of the mouths are caused by packing. Okay? And in 2016... You little bastard. In 2016, bear me 2 seconds, guys. Okay, where's that gone? Okay, I'll pull up the numbers. We had it jumped up to, okay, I haven't got the details there. In 2016, we had 9 distorted canopies. 1 packing bungees caused a bag lock. 20 tension knots. Okay, and then there's another one in there as well, which was a tension knot, which led to another incident, which I'll talk about in a second. And there were 10 twists. Okay, so if you include the twists, because it's always the packer's fault, 90% of the mouths were caused by packing. Okay, not gear failure. Okay, not other stuff. Like last year we had one side spin, one drogue around the student, one incorrect sequence on the handles, which is actually on the BPA tandem course. All right. One brake fire and three brakes stuck on. So if we take those out, 90% of the mals out of 51 mals were caused by packing. All right, so we need to look at what we're doing with the packing. And the chance of a mal was 0.8, it was 0.86 per 1,000 jumps, okay? Now, looking at this with the twists, we have the twist split is about 60-40 between Icarus and Sigmas, the percentage-wise. So I know the Icarus has, we all our mals at Hibblestow are on Icarus, predominantly caused by twists. Okay, that's because we do a lot of tandems and we use Icarus canopies. Okay, so when I was trying to look at it, the split is there between looking at them. So it can occur on anything. Okay, I can't identify if it is one canopy or another one because I don't know which centres are using what equipment and how many jumps they're doing on that kit. Okay, so I haven't got that. So we need to look at our own centres when we go back. One thing I could find though was looking at the tandem instructor currency. All right, and we were and only five of the 51 incidents. Okay, well you say only five, but five of the 51 incidents were instructors which had less than 20 jumps in the previous 3 months. Okay, so it wasn't like 90% of them have been 90% of the mals have been caused by uncurrent instructors. You know, it can happen at any time. It was any range of instructor currency, any range of instructor numbers. And this is only at the first level of statistics, guys. I haven't got the details to be able to go any deeper. Okay, but I was expecting personally more to be with uncurrent instructors. But I couldn't, at first glance, I couldn't see that. Okay, so it can happen at any time to anybody. Okay, some of these things. But there is an elephant in the room. Okay, these are incidents which everyone's got down. Now, there have been some injuries, which I'll look at in a moment. There is an elephant in the room, though, but we have had some really, really serious incidents that are there. We've had a cutaway where the free bag didn't come out of the container. Near enough. People had low deployments in reserve. We've had a chest strap undone. We've had multiple top hooks come off in the last 5 years. And we've had one tandem instructor who left the aircraft still attached by the seatbelt to the aircraft. Okay. And then we've had last year one where the cutaway cable shredded itself. You little swine. Shredded itself and the main canopy after tension knots didn't release. The RSL pulled and we had a main reserve entanglement. Okay. I can get you the photos. I can show you the photos later on the one that's coming up. But with that one, we were fortunate. The instructor carried on trying. Tried to cut through the risers, managed to clear the line off them as the canopy's downplaned and then cut the line, which was holding it around the students, so they landed unentangled under the reserve, but it was only cleared at 500 feet. So we have been very, very close. We are always skirting around that plug hole, aren't we? And I think that we have to be careful because the stats aren't bad. Okay, our injury rate, our fatality rate is 0.000. And we haven't had a fatality in the last 24 years, I think I'd have to be corrected on, 24, 25 years, okay? And we're getting information so we can look at trends, so that's one good thing. I spoke to the USPA, I spoke to their safety guy, Jim Crouch, and he's like, I can't tell you how many males we're having, I can't tell you how many injuries we're having. They don't report it, they don't look at it, okay? The only thing is, the only statistic they can give us is fatality is 0.02 per 1,000 jumps. So, because they are killing people. So, there is some good stuff that we're doing, but we've got to remember that we are always skirting around that plug hole, but it's only going to take one incident for it to end up as a fatality.
Sorry, Noel, you mentioned before about the majority of it being packer incidents, and yet there's no correlation between that and currency. Is that right? Tandem instructors?
I can't rule that out, but I can't, at first impressions looking at it, I can't see it.
Would you be looking at the difference between those particular uncurrent
I would have to go into that further detail. I would have to go back and look at that. I can't say that, and I can't. I don't want to put blame onto people. No, I can't see. So that is. But that's the next level that we'd have to go into and look at.
Okay.
Okay. Yes, there may well be something there. Okay. And looking at it. Jeff, has it died? Yeah. Okay, I've killed it. Brilliant. Okay. Great, makes it easy. Right, okay, if it's not up there, I can tell you whatever I like now. So moving up, so the injury reports I went through, okay. Looking at it, 2014, 59 injuries. Now, obviously, you can get all these stats as well by looking at the minutes and stuff like that from STC. All right, but how many of you bother to read that? Okay, we don't always read it unless we're there at the thing. So, but it, you can look at stuff, and generally, if there is anything pertinent, it will be in there, okay? In 2014, 59 injuries, 6 were to the instructors, 53 to students. Okay, 34 of those were caused on landing. Okay, there's outlying things there as well. There's hard openings, okay, which crops up. Okay, there's people getting injured because they haven't got the chin strap excess tucked away. It's reported, okay, so a bit of bruising is reported the same as what a fracture is. Okay, so what I've done is I've tried and take out the stuff which is not landing related, okay, and to remove that because I think that distorts our figures. It actually makes us look worse, okay. So I looked at, there's 34 landing injuries, okay. 34 landing injuries, which is 59% of the issues in 27% of those, 27 of the 34 injured on landing students were overweight, obese or very obese. That's 79% were overweight. Okay. 2015, 56 injuries, 9 to instructors, 47 to students. 37 of those were landing, so 66. So that year actually looks a lot better, but you know, we're not hurting them on landing, we're hurting them other ways, which are all tend to be minor, they're bruisings. We don't get fractures when we have a hard opening, we get bruising and stuff like that. 24 of those landing injuries out of 37 were to overweight, obese, or very obese people, 65%. Okay, and there were 7 dislocations that year. Okay, 7 dislocations in 2014. Now, dislocations, I don't think we can do anything about, but they distort our figures. Because the dislocations, either the person's never had a dislocation before and it happens in free fall. It's a different position they may never have been into with the force. It's going to come out. They might have had a partial dislocation, which they don't admit to because our paperwork says it's a dislocation. Oh, it only half came out. It's not a dislocation. Or they've dislocated it 17 times, but they want to go skydiving, so they lie through their teeth to you. So dislocations I've kind of disregarded. There's very little we can do about that. But obviously with a dislocation, we stand an increased risk of hurting them on landing because they can't put their legs up, they're in pain, they could pass out from the pain. So we need to, but you know, it's something you need to ask them sort of thing as you're gearing up possibly, you know, or look at them and see, you know, it's hard. I can't draw much more from that sort of thing on the dislocations. In 2016, we had 5 dislocations. Now, 2016, the information that was coming through on the paperwork was clearer for me to look at. I was getting more detail. So, for not landed related injuries, 2 were bruising due to poorly fitted kit. 1 was a chin strap, excess coming around, giving them a nice big welt. 1 was a necklace. 5 were dislocations. Well, I can't control them. 2 were bruising due to harnesses. 1 was in the arm and 1 was in the testicle. Okay, I don't know whether that was the instructor or the student, okay. Regarding the safeguard, and I don't know how we would apply first aid for that one, so I'll leave that one to Sarah to deal with, okay. 7 were people passing out, okay, only 4 of which were overweight, okay. 1, you know, previous history, 1 was hadn't eaten and stuff like that, so, you know. There, 3 bruising due to hard openings, only 1 of those was overweight. And 2 were injuries sustained in the canopy entanglement, I can't see you, which was fortunately some line burn on a foot on the instructor and a fractured rib on the student, which could have been a damn sight worse. So actually, they're quite pretty good injuries to get out of that scenario, and I don't think any of us would swap that when you look at the photos of it.
How are you defining overweight? BMI?
BMI. Going from the information I got, the BPA of the calculation, the BMI on there, and it's 27.5. I think it's 29.30 or whatever it is, 35, okay. But we know that BMI is a catch-all, I'm obese. It's not perfect, but it gives us a guideline, okay. 35 out of the 53 injuries were overweight, totally, okay. And 27 of the 32 landing injuries were all attributed to the student dropping their legs. Okay, so 32 landing injuries, 27 were attributed to the student. 20 of those were overweight. That's 74% of those people who were injured were overweight. Okay, 12 of those 20 ended up with fractures. Okay, 5 were heavy landings. 2 explicitly blamed the instructor. One was a foot caught in long grass, which hurt the instructor. And one was a poor flare. 80% of those heavy landings were overweight. So the trend's pretty obvious, isn't it, really? It's the overweight people. If we can look at that and reduce that risk, we can improve our statistics dramatically. Okay. So the numbers are going down. The incidents, the injuries are going down, and to me, it's the weight side. Look at it. Now, I'm never going to talk about how to fit the harness properly to reduce that risk. Okay. But what we need to look at first of all, I'm already talking to the converted because you're here, you're listening. We need to go back, and what we need to think about is the conditions that we're jumping in. Is it suitable? Okay, I'm teaching you to suck eggs because you're already here. Are the conditions suitable for them? Okay, are they able? If you're not sure, check. Suspend them, get them to pick their legs up and see.
Are any of these data being analysed in terms of location, as in drop zone, and individual?
Not at the level I've got, because I haven't got those details. It would have to be done. I was given this in confidence with the numbers, if that may, they wanted to keep we don't want to attribute blame to people. I'm not here to sit down and say that drop zone B is safer than drop zone C.
I mean, I think probably most people in this room would agree with me that they know tandem instructors on whom they would not put their nearest and dearest.
Well, we'll come back. We can look at that. That's something we can look at, which we need to come down to. But sticking with this decision, we need to. So going back, obviously, with those who are classes overweight, we need to be looking at them first of all to make sure that the equipment's fitted properly, their capability for them. Okay, are they able to pick their own legs up? If we're not sure, we need to test them. All right, and also we have a whole range of instructors in this room, from people who have zero tandems to those who've got 10,500 or 13,000 tandems. Okay, so we have a whole range. So we need to check our capabilities, our currency, our abilities. We need to stop, and we need to not be afraid to say no. Okay, because the one thing, when I was chief instructor, the one thing that the sentence I used to hear was, I knew they were going to drop their legs. Well, why the bloody hell did you take them? You know, we are the last people. Say again. Money. Well, yeah, that's, yeah, it is. It's moolah, isn't it? Okay, well, we'll come on to that in a second, But that's not what you, and it's hard to defend then. It's hard to defend. So we need to look at that. So we need to think about it. Yes?
If we want to focus on improving things, why have we got rid of the medical one?
Why haven't we?
Why have we got rid of the medical for over 40?
I don't know.
Because that's only going to go the other way.
Has there been an increase in injuries?
I can answer that.
Yeah.
If you had a student who was anything up to about 45 years old, all you had to do was dye their hair until you were 39. You don't ask for a passport, so even the 40-year bit didn't really work. So people could lie, and it was just discriminatory, just pure arbitrary, the 40, because there was no evidence to say that anybody over 40 was more likely to get hurt or actually needed a medical. There you go.
Thank you, Mark. Andy? I'm not trying to blame the student.
No, I mean, we're
we need to look after the student. Not every, yeah, but it's kind of the catch-all. We have a rating, okay, which means that we can take everybody. But can we actually take everybody? We have a whole range of people, whole range of sizes. Can we take all those weights? That's what we need to look at. And we need to say, no, we need to be looking at that ourselves, don't we? That's what we need to be dealing as instructors. And that's the one thing we need to be working together as teams. And what, you know, like we've got the very, very experienced instructors in the room and we've got the lower experience and we need to be working as a team on flight line. Hang on a second, that's beyond your skill limit. Okay, and then people need help. And that's where we need a mentoring system for the new people. We need a mentoring system to work together through. So, yes, Mark.
Just out of interest, is there any rise in spinal injuries caused by the student landing, like, you know, the old...
Can't tell you. I don't know. We're looking at it.
Quick one. We're taking a lot of older people. Bones get more brittle as they get older, more liable to break something. A younger person might not break something with the same impact on the ground. Is there any correlation to age within that data?
I haven't gone through to that depth. Okay. I've only looked at, like I say, this is all very first level, so I can't tell you the depth and the variance and the mean and stuff like that. Yes, Jim?
Doesn't this give us more ammunition to go down the near miss route, like the Military Aviation Authority and the CAA?
Well, yeah, but what we should be developing a near miss route, near miss thing in your own system, in your own drop zone. That's the first place for it to start. That's what we need to be doing. We need to be working. We need to be looking at one another. We need to be watching videos, exits, you know, and we need the mentoring system. And I think if you've got a mentoring system that people work together between more experienced and lesser, to get people to work together in terms of that, then you're going to develop that near miss situation, an open culture in your own drop zone where people are going to be wanting, they are going to come and say, I was fortunate with the guys that I had when I was chief instructor, and I think the culture is still continuing at Hilblestow, because I can only talk from there, that often if an instructor had a poor exit, they would come to me first of all, can you come and have a look at this? Because they know that the cameraman would also come and have a word sort of thing. But the cameraman wouldn't say anything to embarrass their mate because they knew that the instructor would probably come and do it. And then we'd have a chat about it and we'd try and look at it from an EMS, things like that. And that's what we've got to try and develop within our own space, okay? So looking at it and looking at some of the stuff, what... We go through back to what you guys are saying. What do we want? We want a You know the quote that Donald Rumsfeld has? We have the known knowns, the unknown knowns, and we've got the unknown unknowns, basically. Okay. We know that we've got the known knowns. We have a low rate from people turning low. They're not that the injuries are not written down as low turns. We have a low injury rate from people going out of sequence on deployment and stuff like that. Okay. We know the unknowns. We need to be looking at our equipment, okay? We need to have our own, looking at manufacturer's guidelines, our own riggers' guidelines for the wear and tear on the equipment, okay? For argument's sake, the centre line in the next is £40 to replace. It's the cheapest component on there, okay? It's cheaper than the side hook, okay? You need to replace it. It's simple, okay? We shouldn't be getting broken kill lines. So we need to be doing that. We need to be working with our riggers and looking at that and trying to develop that. But then we've also got the unknown unknowns, the stuff we don't, and the stuff which we can't control, because all the time that we make all these rules and we make the kit better, we have people who are trying to prove Darwin wrong every single day, and we make better holes and we breed better idiots to get through the holes, okay? So we're trying to look at it, and the thing is, we are hurting them on landing. So that's the one thing, that's the first place we've got to go and look at. We've got to look at our landings, okay? And I've been trying to look at it, trying to think about it, what we can do. Basically, what do we want from a landing? Well, first of all, selfishly, we want a landing that we walk away from, because then you get paid. Okay. We want a landing that the student walks away from. Well, we walk away from, and the student walks away from, because then we don't get sued. Okay. Then you've got to go at the next level. What do we want? We want a landing that looks good on camera. Let's face it. We want a landing that looks good on camera in front of the cameraman, and we want a landing that looks better than our mates. Okay. So. There is some ego in there, but if we take the ego out of it and we can learn from it, hopefully we can improve it. And what I was thinking about was who's got the best landings and where can we learn these techniques? And not saying that they've got the best landings, but I looked at competition accuracy swoopers. Okay, that's what we're doing on every single jump. We're doing an accuracy landing with a high performance canopy in conditions that are varying every single jump, the weight, the wind, the temperature. Okay. or a demo if you're looking at it, and we are doing a demo landing in front of a crowd, in front of cameras, in front of mobile phones. So if you screw up, within 3 seconds it'll be on Facebook. Okay, so going back and thinking what we can do sort of thing, and looking at the competition swoopers, you know, they'll go and practice a turn, they take the input out of the canopy by a certain height to allow the canopy to fly. And a lot of times, a lot of stuff I've seen, I looked at some videos for the BPA, the inputs are not being removed, the canopies are not having time to recover. It's normal flight before we're coming into the flare. We're carrying some input through and expecting this big canopy to flare and get us out of it. Okay? We can't go and train like competition swoopers who will go and spend months and months and months doing training jumps. All right? We are in competition straight away from 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning. Okay?
Do you have any correlation to performance of canopy to injury rates? We've seen a lot of 300+ tandems now.
No, I don't. Because we have some centres which are jumping. I don't have the numbers per centre because that's confidential business. Okay, which is fair enough. I don't want to get into that. To the size of the thing, to the size of the canopy, or relative to the experience of the instructor. That's far level. You'd have to have somebody independent do that who's not has any commercial interest in it, can't be used then. So we need to look at that, and the one thing looking at the competition swoopers, okay, they get a turn, you learn a turn, then you learn to move the turn through the gates, and you put it. They're not correcting the turn, okay, they're correcting the position of the turn. We need to think about that, our setup points, and where does that go back to? It all comes back to the stack. If we can create a less hectic stack, if we can have more control in the stack, everybody has a better chance of having a better landing. We take the stress out then. A congested stack puts a stress. So an injury at our place, a guy landed off, got stressed about it, forgot to put the secondaries up. Broken ankle. Okay? It comes down to stress management, doesn't it? So let's give ourselves less stress. And what I would really recommend is that people go away. If you have a look at your own centre, spend a day, get someone to film stack and the landings, because it's not just for landings, it's for stack which create the stress, which create the poor landings. Go back, look at the whole stack, look at how you're working, think about the stack, think about where the experience is in the stack, and try and work back from that sort of thing. Spend a day, have a look at it, review it, work together, and get the guys who are more experienced to mentor the less experienced ones. Okay, spend some time to self-examine what's going on. Okay, and even if you don't do that, examine your own landings. That was a bit hard. Why was it a bit hard? Think back, okay? And think about if the input has been taken out of the canopy, because the canopy will only do what you tell it to do. If it's got a turn and it's carrying a partial turn through, although it's not a low turn, it might not be a big turn, it's still going down. We're still losing altitude. And before you flare, it's not going to give you that lift. So go back, look, and be that retrospective look at what you're doing. Okay? I mean, I know I'll put my hands up, I go last a lot of the time and then I'm ding dong, ding dong, ding dong. And the thing I suddenly realise, I'm looking at this, my cameraman stays still because he knows I'm gonna land in front of him. If the catchers are running around because they're inexperienced, they're a mirror of your pattern as you're coming in to land, aren't they? So if your catchers are running around, your pattern isn't very good, what's that doing to everybody else? Okay, so we need to be thinking about, use the other clues which are there, you know. Watch what's going on, you know. If the catchers are running from the opposite side of the field, okay, is that your accuracy? Is it your mate's accuracy? Do you need to work together? You know, and that's the only time you might need to consider changing your pattern, you know, to get towards the catchers and stuff. Okay, so we need to be looking at the whole picture of what we're doing, okay. And I just think we need to go back and we need to have a look at it, you know. If your landings are not soft, we're not flaring the canopy properly. You know, if we're getting tired, we need to stop and we need to look at that, okay? And just look at how the stacks are working. And then to help with that, go back to first principles. Make sure you know what the conditions are, what the winds are doing at the levels. You know, try and minimise your risk, okay? And so old dogs out there, please help the new guys. New guys, please be brave and go and ask for help. You know, start with that culture inside, work with the near miss inside in your own drop zone, and I think that we will do a lot to reduce it. I've got one last thing and then I'm done. One last thing. The thing I ask for you about statistics is don't become a statistic. Think about what you're doing. Go home and think about it.
First, ask your question.
No, Chris.
Yeah, what I'm saying though is that you're one of those landings and you know.
female staff, if you look at that, the vast majority of them are overweight.
Yes.
So you still have that. You still have that.
Sit on your hands.
Initial problem there. Now we done a thing at our centre all 3, 4, 5 years ago, I think, something like that, where we looked at the BMI, and there's a thing you can get on. If you Google it, BMI, it goes from 1 to 10 in body shape.
Yeah.
And what we found when people walked through the door and we went, yeah, no, maybe.
Yeah.
We found that on that scale of 1 to 10 of how they define the body shape, anybody above an 8 was a no.
Yeah.
Your middle ground, your 6s and 7s are the ones where you look at and go, maybe. You put them in a harness and see how they get on.
Yeah, but that's the thing. That's what you're doing. You're actually checking, and that's what I want people to think about.
The landings, you can improve the landings, but if people aren't sussing them out when they walk through the door and go, yeah, you might have signed your medical to say there ain't no way you're going to get your legs up.
Yeah, it's a combination of the two.
So
yes,
yeah.
It is. They're not separable. They're not separable. All we're showing is that those who are overweight have a higher risk of injury.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, that stops.
That stops the office door. But for those who are not overweight, we need to think about the landings as well. So it's in combination of the two. So if they're not separable. But if we can look at the conditions that we're jumping the overweight people in, then we stand a chance of reducing those statistics.
What should we be taking in the first place?
If the conditions are suitable. And then that comes down to your chief instructor and the conditions on the day, the kit you're using. So in the right conditions, we should be able to reduce the risk. We cannot remove the risk.
Some of this overweight people business will be addressed by this harness fitting, I'm sure.
Hopefully, yes. Part of it is that if a poorly fitted harness is not helping, is hindering somebody who is overweight picking their legs up.
Sure.
Yes. No, that's the point of it.
I think it's fair to say that these problems are not the student problem. They make them less forgiving of our mistakes. That's a point that should be made. You know, we should be doing it right.
Yeah.
It may be harder. We might have less margin for error with some people than with others.
Yeah.
But I believe there is a result of our mistakes, and our mistake might be taken in the first place. But
yeah, that's right, and that's what we need to look at. We need to look on flight line, and you know, if it gets to flight line, the key thing is that you are the last person who's going to stop this incident. Yeah, but you are the last. Yes, I agree with you, Chris.
It hasn't worked.
Yeah, it hasn't worked, but again, you are the last person who can stop it. And that's also where people have got to be brave. Just because they've got through the system doesn't mean that they're okay to go jump in. And so it's a two-way thing. Both the officer has got to stop it, and the instructors on flight line have got to be brave enough to stop it.
Yeah, sorry, when I say office, we have instructors in the office, so
yeah.
That's what I mean, is instructors, sorry. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Oh, 1 second. Sorry, Pete.
Yeah, very briefly. Just really, what I think Andy's leading to is we're looking at additional risk. So, if somebody's got limited mobility or if somebody's overweight, is that an additional risk which then needs to be looked at and allowed for, or a decision made? And one of the problems is on flight lane is that the instructor who's kit receiving them, maybe already kitted up, may not have that additional risk information.
Yeah, that's fair enough. Yeah, yeah. Well, that comes down to that's it. That can be central. That's a centre-specific thing, sort of thing. That if you are having other people gear up your student, that the instructor would probably be the person who's checking the harness before they go jumping. So then, at that point, there is an opportunity then. So that's what we need to look at. And I can't tell you what to do, but that's something. If your centre does that, then you need to look at. Yes, and you're right. But we have to, and that's the thing that. We have to understand there are people who are going to have a higher risk, and it's just getting people to accept that. It's not a roller coaster, is it? You know, where, you know, if the harness shuts down on you, bang, you can go on the roller coaster. And I think that it's been brave enough to say, sorry, the conditions are not right. We need to look at that. It's a combination of the two. All right, thank you. I'm sorry the presentation didn't work, but if anybody wants any more information about it, come and see me afterwards. It's fine. The one thing which Reg Brookwell took to, 1 second, was the only country I got details out of in terms of mals and injuries was New Zealand, because the States don't have the details. The New Zealand rate was 0.77. Okay, ours was 0.86, but theirs is per 10,000. They had 31 mals in 91,000 tandems. So our mal rate's 3 times higher than theirs. Their injury rate was I'd have to check it, but 0.7 or 0.8 or something. Again, per 10,000, our risk is 10 times higher than theirs. And I think that from my own experience, having worked in New Zealand, with the weight, you know, the young kids coming through, the tourists, that it is the weight which is the issue. And no matter where, it's got to be addressed. And if we look at it, then we can deal with it. Okay, thank you for your patience.